Hi there, this is Mark and I'm inviting you to join me in reading through the Bible this year. I've made it my practice over the last 50 years or so to read all the way through the Bible once every year at least. So we're starting in Genesis and I'll be making comments on the way through as well. Genesis 1 verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, "Let there be an expanse in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters." And God made the expanse, and separated the waters that were under the expanse from the water that was over the expanse. And it was so. And God called the expanse heaven. And there was evening, and there was morning, the second day. And God said, "Let the waters under the heavens be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear." And it was so. And God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called seas. And God saw that it was good. And God said, "Let the earth sprout vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees bearing fruit, in which is their seed, each according to its kind, on the earth." And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed according to their own kinds, and trees bearing fruit, in which is their seed, each according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the third day. And God said, "Let there be lights in the expanse of the heavens to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons, for days and years, and let them be lights in the expanse of the heavens to give light upon the earth." And it was so. And God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day, the lesser light to rule the night, and the stars. And God set them in the expanse of the heavens to give light on the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fourth day. And God said, "Let the waters swarm with swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the expanse of the heavens." So God created the great sea creatures and every living creature that moves with which the waters swarm according to their kinds, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And God blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and multiply, fill the waters and the seas, and let birds multiply on the earth." And there was evening, and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, "Let the earth bring forth living creatures according to their kinds, livestock and creeping things, and beasts of the earth according to their kinds." And it was so. And God made the beasts of the earth according to their kinds, and the livestock according to their kinds, and everything that creeps on the ground according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over the livestock, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. And God blessed them. And God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply in the earth, and fill the earth, and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over every living thing that moves on the earth." And God said, "Behold, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is on the face of all the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the heavens, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has the breath of life, I have given every green plant for food. And it was so. And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. And so ends chapter 1 of Genesis. I'm reading from the English Standard Version, the ESV, and you can look that up online, you can see that online, or you can buy your own and follow with me. And I suggest that you do follow with me whenever you have a chance to do so. I intend to take about half an hour with these readings, and I'll take a part from Genesis, I'll take a little from the New Testament, and maybe a psalm and a little of Proverbs. And that's usually how I do my readings each day. So I'm just inviting you to join with me to go through the Bible. As I say, I've been through the Bible probably about 50 times over my lifetime. I used to do 2 times a year. Now I tend to just make it 1 time through a year. And I'm just inviting you to join me for that as well. So let's take a look at Genesis 1 before we move on to the New Testament. So it says here, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. It's talking about how God created the earth. It's possible to have that reading, and the earth became without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. That's also a possible interpretation. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. Now, I like to take the Bible as it stands. This is God's word, and unless there's a very good reason to read it in a different way, or unless other parts of Scripture explain it in a different way, generally what is written is the way I will read it and the way I will take it as understood. So when God says the evening and the morning was the first day, I take that as a day of creation, just a normal, ordinary day, especially since it says the evening and the morning. And the very first thing that God creates is day and night. Now we move down to a little bit further where it says in verse 4, in verse 14, God said, let there be lights in the expanse of the heaven to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons, for days and years. And let them be lights in the expanse of the heaven to give light upon the earth. And it was so. And God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day, the lesser light to rule the night, and the stars. Now you'll notice that God actually made day and night. The very first thing he created was light, and he separated the light from the darkness. That's day one. And here in day four, God made the two great lights. The word made can be rendered, he formed them. It doesn't necessarily mean that the sun was in its initial stages of being created. He molded or formed the sun at that time. It may have been that the sun had a different form at the beginning, or it may have been another light source. We're not told exactly what that light source was on day one. So we need not think, as some people think, that on day three, when God created the vegetation, that there was no sun for photosynthesis. No, there was already day and night, and we see that from earlier on. And we notice that verse 5, verse 6, we finally get to the high point of God's creation. God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. That's verse 27. Male and female, he created them. And God blessed them and said, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, the birds of the heavens, and over every living thing that moves on the earth. The high point of God's creation is man. Man is special. As far as God is concerned, and Jesus himself points this out on the Sermon on the Mount, man is worth more than the animals. We have a very common unfortunately, in our Western society, a common idea that man and animals, they're about worth the same, that people aren't worth more than their dogs. That is absolutely wrong, according to the Word of God. When Jesus talks about our Heavenly Father looking after us, he says, God knows when even when a sparrow falls. And his comment together with that was, you are worth more than many sparrows. More than many sparrows. We, as God's final creation, mankind, are worth more, much more, than all the animals. We are created in God's image. We have eternity in our hearts. So God saw that everything he had made, and behold, it was very good. There was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. I want to point out straight away that nowadays, we can look around and we see death and suffering. We see hatred between nations. We see families torn apart. We see some terrible things on this earth, and it's not very good. But when God created mankind, when God created this earth, it was very good. There was no evil in it whatsoever. Whatever God creates is good, because God is a good God. There is no evil with him. The Bible tells us that God is light. In him is no darkness at all. And we serve a God, at least I do, that is a good God. A God I can trust always to be good. And he said he's unchanging. He's not going to turn into the bad guy. He's always going to be our Heavenly Father, the one who loves us and the one who looks after us. Well, so ends chapter 1 of Genesis. We'll go over to chapter 1 of Matthew as our next reading. It should take around about 30 minutes a day of your time, and we'll get through the whole of the Bible one day at a time. I finished 4 days early this year, around the 26th or 27th of December, simply doing three chapters or three and a third chapters on average per day. So we turn over to the book of Matthew. Matthew is the start of the New Testament. The Old Testament begins with Genesis. Testament, by the way, means covenant or agreement. And under the Old Agreement, which was written mostly for the Jews or those who became part of the Jewish religion, the Old Testament was written for them. The New Testament was written for everyone. There's a new agreement that God has made with all of us. Anyone that wants to come into his family, into God's own family, can do so. So the Bible tells us that the New Testament is based on new and better promises than the Old Testament. So let's read from the start of Matthew, Matthew chapter 1. The book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac, Isaac the father of Jacob, Jacob the father of Judah and his brothers, Judah the father of Perez and Zerah by Tamar, and Perez the father of Hezron, Hezron the father of Ram, Ram the father of Amminadab, Amminadab the father of Nahshon, Nahshon the father of Salmon, Salmon the father of Boaz by Rahab, and Boaz the father of Obed by Ruth, and Obed the father of Jesse, and Jesse the father of David the king. King David, of course, was one of the famous Old Testament kings. And as we read through the Old Testament, we'll understand who these people are that are written in this genealogy that we have at the start of Matthew. And it's the genealogy that of Jesus Christ. And we read through, and David, and this is verse 6, David was the father of Solomon by the wife of Uriah, Solomon the father of Rehoboam, Rehoboam the father of Abijah, Abijah the father of Asaph, and Asaph the father of Jehoshaphat, Jehoshaphat the father of Joram, Joram the father of Uzziah, Uzziah the father of Jotham, Jotham the father of Ahaz, Ahaz the father of Hezekiah, Hezekiah the father of Manasseh, Manasseh the father of Amos, Amos the father of Josiah, Josiah, the father of Jeconiah and his brothers, at the time of the deportation to Babylon. See, the Jews were taken into captivity into Babylon at that time. And after the deportation to Babylon, Jeconiah was the father of Shealtiel. Shealtiel, the father of Zerubbabel. Zerubbabel, the father of Abiud. Abiud, the father of Eliakim. Eliakim, the father of Azor. Azor, the father of Zadok. Zadok, the father of Achan. Achan, the father of Eliud. Eliud, the father of Eleazar. Eleazar, the father of Matthan. Matthan, the father of Jacob. Jacob, the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom Jesus was born, who is called Christ. So what we have here in Matthew is the genealogy of Joseph. Joseph being the stepfather of Jesus, Christ himself. In Luke, you can take a look and you'll find the genealogy of Jesus through Mary, his mother. Verse 17 of Matthew, chapter 1. So all the generations from Abraham to David were 14 generations. From David to the deportation of Babylon, 14 generations. From the deportation to Babylon to the Christ, 14 generations. Christ, by the way, is the same as the word Messiah in the Old Testament. It means the anointed one. Now, the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. You see, in those days, if a woman was found to be pregnant by someone other than her husband, she was in danger of being stoned to death. That was the standard punishment meted out for adultery. And of course, it looked very much like Mary had another person. She was promised to Joseph, which was equivalent of the marriage covenant, by the way. And here she was pregnant before they came together. But she was pregnant by the Holy Spirit. It was God's doing. But as he considered, as Joseph considered divorcing her, as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel. And that is cited from Isaiah, chapter 7, verse 14. That prophecy was written 700 years before Jesus was born. The virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they'll call his name Emmanuel, meaning God with us, which means God with us. When Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but he knew her not. He didn't have intimate relations with her until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus. So the birth of Jesus was foretold, as we can see. It was written in numerous places, but one of them Matthew points out here in verse 23. The virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they'll call his name Emmanuel, God with us. And so ends the reading of the first chapter of Matthew in the New Testament. Just one more reading today we'll have, and that's Psalm 1, the first psalm. Now, sometimes these will be, the readings will be a bit longer than others, sometimes shorter, but it's just an opportunity for you to join me, because I love the Word, and there's so much in it. And as we go through, I'll point out some of the things that that I've picked up as I've been reading through all these years. So we're looking here in Psalm 1 as our final reading. Psalm 1, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And on his law He meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted by streams of water that yields its fruit in its season. Its leaf does not wither. In all that he does, he prospers. The wicked are not so. They are like the chaff that the wind drives away. Therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. Blessed or happy is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked. Now, here's a psalm that really speaks to our heart, doesn't it? It's so easy for us, with our modern technology, TV, the news, anything at our fingertips. The world's values very quickly can be absorbed by us as Christians, and God calls us to be separate from them. Blessed is the one who doesn't walk in the counsel of the wicked. The counsel of the wicked means that we don't follow God's laws. And God's laws, as we'll find out, are quite different to the way most people live. We don't walk in the counsel of the wicked, nor stand in the way of sinners. We don't follow the way that sinners live and sinners act, nor sit in the seat of scoffers. We don't sit back and mock the people who are trying to do what is right. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. When the Bible talks about the law, it's usually talking about the five books of Moses, the first five books of the Bible: Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. That contains God's law to the Israelites. And so the delight of the one who loves God, this is Old Testament, is in the law of God and seeing what God desires of us and living that way. It's true for those that are in the New Testament as well, because Jesus himself has said not one dot or cross of the T will depart from the law until everything is fulfilled. The Lord gives us the way we ought to live. Jesus actually introduced an even higher law for us as Christians, and that's the law of love. We should love the Lord our God with all our heart, our soul, our mind, our strength, and love our neighbour as ourselves. And that's an even higher law than than the Ten Commandments would give us, for example. And then there's the promise. His delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. And here's the promise. He's like a tree planted by streams of water that yields its fruit in its season. Its leaf does not wither. And all that he does, he prospers. Now that's an amazing promise to those who delight in the law of God. God is going to look after them. He's going to prosper them. They're like the tree planted by the streams of water. It's not going to wither. It's going to stay strong right through even the hard times. The wicked are not so. They're like the chaff the wind drives away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment. And that's another issue. When we die, that's not the end. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 29, I think. It talks about the judgment. It's appointed unto man once to die, and after death comes the judgment. The wicked won't stand there, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. Well, thank you for joining me for this first of the readings this year. I hope to continue making one a day. And you're very welcome to join me, and we will, as I say, be able to read all the way through from Genesis to Revelation if we continue on in this way. Thanks again for joining me. I'm Mark Bredfeld, and have a happy new year.